You mentioned a bank investment company or a bank holding company. A couple of ideas keep coming back, right? Every budget, whether it's a DFI, to fund infrastructure, or it's a bank holding company, to take care of PSU bank ownership, or it's even a bad bank. What's the realistic expectation on any of these? And if you can go one by one and tell me, whether you think they're really needed at this point in time or not.
India has this great opportunity over the next 10, 20 years to grow at 10% plus. The world is looking for an alternate to China. I don't think we can replace China, and that should not be our aim, but we can clearly become the alternate manufacturing hub that protects IPRs and others for the rest of the world. If we have to build a real economy like that, you need a very strong domestic financial services economy or sector. So you need Atmanirbhar financial services for Atmanirbhar India. That does not mean don't bring in whatever foreign capital you can. Bring that in, but know that that foreign capital is also responsible. It will move somewhere else if it needs to. So in parallel, build a very strong Indian financial services sector. Now, that's at a broad level. At the immediate level, when 70% of banking is state-owned banks, and if they are not going to extend credit, we are not going to see any great growth in the economy. So how do you get them to extend credit? One, they are saddled with bad loans. You have to take it off their books. That's where the bad bank or multiple bad banks open up. We can see today ARCs are still small in India, but are slowly helping in resolution of stressed companies. Open up these loans of bad banks to alternate investment funds and other such structures so that they can come in and professionally run it, because they are used to buying such distressed debt all over the world, many of these fund managers. So open that up. That gives some breathing space to the PSBs. You then need to capitalize them to be able to grow. Now, you can't capitalize all of them, and that's where the keep the strategic ones and divest the rest. That's where that point of view comes from. The ones then you capitalize, you better professionalize as well, because otherwise you'll be faced with the same bad debt situation 10 years down the line. And we have seen that cycle in the past. So it's not one element, and that's why you hear so many things, because it all follows one after the other. Large projects, even today, if Germany, Korea, China can have large government-owned domestic institutions, domestic financial institutions, the DFIs, I think we folded ours too prematurely and converted them into regular banks. But that's also because we needed banks 25 years ago. So the timing is good right now to create one or two large ones for infrastructure, further capitalize NABARD for agriculture and agricultural support, both rural and urban. Use SIDBI for MSME and SMEs. You have some of those entities already available, because we have to go now with all guns blazing as a financial services sector to support the real economy. Otherwise, we will grow at 6%. Hindu rate of growth used to be 3%. That will now be 6%. But we will lose that 10% opportunity.
You're suggesting that a bad bank to help public sector banks deal with their bad loans, a bank investment company to help sort of, create a second layer and ability to capitalize the good ones, and a development financial institution, are all three efforts that you would want in this budget, and you expect that they would work in lockstep?
So the first and the third, yes, as far as a bank holding company is concerned, that is one structure by which then the government is one step away from direct ownership, but they can even keep their direct ownership in a few banks and in the rest divest. So that's more a question of what works for them. But the first one, the need to create those bad banks and take the bad cholesterol outside of the system of the public sector banks, and the development financial institution are both very important, because today our infrastructure projects, part of the challenges of infrastructure projects is that legal cases, getting land, getting other approvals, always ends up taking longer than required. And to get long-term debt in this country at attractive rates is very difficult. For example, I would mention one more point. As insurance companies, we have to keep 50% of our investments in government securities. I think that should be brought down to 25%. We will be forced to deploy them into long-term capital requirements. So we will become a supplier of capital for long-term infrastructure projects. So you have to think of various ways in which you can match the duration of the project with the duration of money that you hold. And that's where the DFI comes into effect. That's where insurance and pension money comes into play. But each of these need to be then aligned to achieve that end purpose.
So you don't see a challenge in capitalizing either a bad bank or several bad banks, whatever the structure is, or even a DFI. You think there's enough domestic money available, including maybe some government capital or seed capital, to be able to do this?
Yes, I think so. Because the opportunity is there. Instead, as the world sees our intent getting converted into action, you will see that capital coming in. And also, let's keep in mind, the world is flush with money. It will stay flush for the next 18 months, 2 years. But at some point of time, the pandemic, in its seriousness, is going to be behind us. And governments will start tightening their belts. Now, we can already see with China that they are sucking up a lot of this money. So either we do it as well. And of course, there are safeguards around it. So how much will you do? What kind of safeguards do you put in place? What does it do to your currency rates? You have to look at some of these things. But there are very smart people there doing that. We might as well attract some of that now because it won't exist 18 to 24 months down the line.